the quads are doing the work that the psoas is supposed to be doing.
Right. So the quads are supposed to do extension. But when now the quads have to do hip flexion, okay, and not knee extension, then what transpires is the quad now has to over-adapt so it gets bigger. So when I can get the psoas working correctly, whether I do some soft tissue or whatever it may be, then guess what? The quad actually decreases its size. The athlete now jumps and runs faster and jumps higher because it's functioning correctly. Hmm. When the body can do its functions correctly, it functions at a very, very high level.
After the episode, head over to iTunes or the Apple Podcast app if you have an iPhone, or the Stitcher app if you have an Android device. Go ahead and subscribe and leave us a 5-star review. We really appreciate that. Enjoy.
Head over to shrugstrengthtest.com and take our free 3-day strength test. We'll send you 3 days of testing that takes about half an hour to about an hour each day. Each day you'll get exercises that we're going to walk you through, showing you step by step what to do. Once you finish the test, submit your results, and then we'll send you a bunch of feedback showing you where we think you could be stronger and then how to fix certain weaknesses that you might have found. Head over to shrugstrengthtest.com to get started.
People, when people ask me, like, well, you don't need to get bigger to be stronger. Really?
Really?
Really? Yeah. I know you don't have to. You can get stronger without getting bigger, but you know what? Big really helps.
It helps. Yeah.
Big really fucking helps.
It's an easier route.
It's just a lot easier.
And it's way more fun. Yeah. Come on.
Like, my gosh. Right. You can,
who loves
you're
the,
330,
who loves
you can move some shit.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. It doesn't matter.
I think we're on.
Why is everyone looking at me? Is it my turn?
Because you're the host.
Welcome to Barbell Shrugged. I'm your host.
Yeah, Andy took over.
Take that off. Get out of here.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
This is my chance now.
You're fired.
This is my shine.
Go ahead. That was pretty good.
No, I don't want to do it. I don't know what to do.
So now you say everyone's name.
Nope.
What's up, guys? Welcome to Barbell Shrugged. I'm your host, Mike McGoldrick, here with Alex Macklin.
What's up?
CTP behind the camera. And our two special guests today, Dr. Andy Galpin and Mr. Cal Dietz.
Coach Cal.
Welcome to the show, guys. Andy's been on several times. Cal, this is your first time. I just met you earlier. Got to hear you speak at the panels. We're here at Paleo FX. There are a lot of really smart people here this weekend. So we put a poll together. We put them through a bunch of like competitions, and we found the two smartest people in the place, and we put them on the show right now. So it's my pleasure to have you guys on.
Who's
so
the other
you.
Guy? It's
Alex.
Not me.
Could be a faulty test.
It's Alex and Mike.
Yeah.
So Cal, tell us a little bit about yourself.
So I'm a strength coach at the University of Minnesota. Been there 15 years. Been part of some great opportunities. Just learning. Been part of 34 Big Ten titles, 11 national championships. Most of my methods and theories have been derived from measurable sports like track and field and swimming. So, for example, a number of years ago, I put together a triphasic method, and what had transpired is these kids, between my track coach figuring this out and the methods that we place, these kids ran the world's fastest times in the 400 2 weeks apart, and we're sitting here going, wow, so we've actually put something together that actually works, you know? And the big thing is those are two measurable sports. For example, Davis Plummer right now, I trained him for a number of years. He's one of the top backstrokers in the world. And you're sitting here going, everything we do, basically in swimming and track and field, we take out all the variables and it's measurable. So, you know, science now with Doc here doing molecular biology can tell me why the triphasic system worked. At the cellular level, I just know it worked because I had a stopwatch.
It was that simple.
Right. 15 years ago or 18 years ago, really, when we started.
So triphasic.
Yeah, can you give us the general kind of overview?
Yeah, so triphasic method I came up with, been part of it, and it's really a system. And essentially, this is the nuts and bolts of the foundation of triphasic. There's many things beyond that. But essentially, you take the first 2 weeks of training, you do an eccentric focus. Okay, and then really the next 2 weeks is an isometric focus, and then the next 2 weeks have those two qualities have set you up to move your weight faster, which is more specific. Okay, and when I say that, the reason we found was that in these world-class athletes, so I have two athletes that were the same level of shot putter, or strength levels, and they were shot putters, but one could throw the weight 10 or the shot 10 feet farther than the other athlete. And they
even
could
though the one rep max was like the same.
440, that was the 200 kilos in her bench press. I'm going, how is that possible? So when I dug in, I realized that the athlete that could bring the bar down fastest and then reverse it quicker had more eccentric strength and isometric strength to stop it and then reapply force. So then I derived my triphasic training system on the ability to separate that and actually just isolate those qualities so that then I got great results. And that's when all these results from these runners and all these Big Ten titles started appearing in the results that we got from triphasic.
So what you mean by – oh, sorry.
I was just going to clarify isometric because you're not saying the 2 weeks you're like holding an isometric push-up position,
no,
right?
We're holding the exact – so let's say the first week your bench is 400 and you're using 360.
Yeah, because you know, that's just what I do, right, 400.
Right. That's what Goldrick says.
Let's just start with something that we all know we can do.
Right. So
135.
You're taking that. So you're taking 360 and you're bringing it down nice and slow for a 7 count. And then you push it up or your partner helps you with a little bit. That's fine. And then that's for 2 weeks of, let's say, 2 bench workouts a week. Yeah. So really 4 workouts.
Eccentric meaning lower than weight, lengthening of the muscle.
Under control.
Yep. Yeah. So – because if you can stop the weight, then you can actually have a better chance of reversing the weight. So then the next 2 weeks is when, after you build the eccentric quality, then you bring the barbell down just above your shoulders and you're holding it at the deepest position for 7 seconds.
This is the isometric phase.
The isometric phase. So then after that isometric phase, and then you push the weight up. So there's 4 weeks of training and really got 8 workouts of bench in. Mm-hmm. And what transpired is then when you bring the bar down and up for the concentric phase, you can move the bar faster and you have more potential for power. Now, what actually goes on in the eccentric phase in the first 2 weeks is that the body remodels its tissue. So there's an immune system response. There's white blood cells. We can get into that. But
you're probably wrecked.
Yeah. And there's a lot of damage, but that damage is good. So sometimes damage is good because it's very specific, and then you're making the tissue stronger and more resilient, so you're less likely to get it injured.
Yeah.
And they've shown now, Doc, you'll confirm, that the eccentric training has produced greater resistance against tendonitis and things like that.
Yeah, so it can be very extremely helpful.
Very interesting, because right now I'm in an Olympic weightlifting cycle. I'm training to do a meet in about 10 weeks, and my knees just started falling apart. So my coach has me doing a lot of eccentric-only singles. We've been doing it for about 2 weeks now, and I actually did a mock meet today. I maxed all my lifts, and I haven't lost any strength, and I've only been doing like 6 or 7 singles at like 95% with like a 6-second tempo. Yes. So like today, you loaded up the bar with 93% back squat, went down for 6 seconds, just dumped the weight. Reset, did that like 6 times.
Sure.
It's very stressful still.
Yes. Yeah. But stress is why we adapt.
Yeah.
So if we apply stress to the organism, so this is basically the triphasic model has been very successful, because it's just, you can load that, you can do the isometric, concentric, or eccentric, concentric model in 6 weeks period in any program. I've literally been emailed 3,000 programs. They're all different.
Yeah.
It's
right.
Just some concepts that you, all my system is some concepts you can place into your own program. I'll be honest with you. I first wrote the book, and a coach out of Canada did a great job. He read my book. He sent me a program, and I actually used his programs because I'm like, man, he did a few things better than mine.
Yeah.
But that, I've been blessed, because this whole system, I released it, and then people have given back to me just little concepts and coaching ideas. So I've been very fortunate. I mean, I have coaches who've emailed me from world champion track athletes to powerlifting. And I hate to say this, a lot of sports use it, but it's not really sport specific. It's what you do prior to getting to your sport specific training cycle. So for example, like powerlifters will do it weeks 12 to 6 in their cycle. And then week 6 to 1, they prepare for their most specific
stuff. The more sport specific,
And the same thing if you're preparing for a CrossFit competition. Let's say you need to get strength and hypertrophy. You can do that with triphasic training a few weeks out, and then you do your normal peaking modification for your normal.
It's your base.
It's your base. Right. Yeah, exactly. So it's a true off-season base, the concepts behind it. But it's fairly simple. It's not that hard to implement. And people are going, wait a minute, you just move the weight slow for 2 weeks, and then you hold it for weeks 3 and 4, and then you really work it moving it. No, that's about it.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot more in my book, but ultimately that's the foundation of it. It's pretty simple.
And it would be something for all movements that you would do, or would you just target specific, like if you plateaued somewhere?
Yeah, so the first time I used it essentially was that I would just do the main lifts. Mm-hmm. But then I just...
Meaning the squat,
yeah,
bench,
squat, bench, your main lifts, maybe pull-ups or whatever, okay. or even deadlifts, but I'd probably do RDLs instead.
Yeah.
But then you go, okay, so then me, I'm thinking, okay, I need to push the limits of humans, and you got to crack a few eggs and make an omelet, so... I was just like, all right, we're going to start using it with every lift. And what I got was even more results.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because here's the thing. Like, the body doesn't necessarily just adapt to one thing in one specific area. I use this example. When I first got to Minnesota, the theory behind training, and that's my unique experience because I've trained how many different types of athletes. I wrote 24 programs a month for 24 different types of athlete, of course. So, and I didn't, you know, my wife was in the Olympics at the time, and I didn't have a lot of social life. I just call her about 9 o'clock at night before she went to bed. She was at the training center.
What sport, if you don't mind?
My wife was Olympic champion in women's ice hockey.
Oh, wow.
Okay,
oh, nice.
Yeah. So my son plays ice hockey now, and he thinks he's good because he's just good at ice hockey. I said, well, it's because I married your mother.
So, was she on the team the first year they won?
Yeah, 98. She was a
man. I remember staying up.
Mike's a hockey.
I remember getting up like three or four in the
yes,
morning to watch that before school when I was in middle
that's
school.
That's
when
it was.
Then. Wow,
yes,
how
was.
Cool.
Yeah, and you know she had the flag after the game. Like,
oh, so
it was
cool.
All, yeah, I mean, but you know, ultimately, so with these athletes, and I just spent a lot of time reading and researching. I can't remember where I was going with this whole deal.
You had an example back from school, and I derailed you.
For the school.
Sounds about right.
I think I derailed you. Yeah, my bad. But, we'll come back to it.
But you're ultimately, you know, with this whole thing, with the hammer thrower, we, you know, the premonition was that they don't want to do a big upper body workout. So I had this kid that came into school, and he benched 316 or 315, back squatted like 450. So he's a freak. And this is it. But what we did was we stopped all upper body training and he got super strong, like put 100 pounds on a squat in 6 months, maybe 125. He did plyometrics. And then 6 months in, he's like, well, I want to see where my bench is at. Maybe it's not as weak as we think. He says, okay, I feel strong. So he actually benched that day 365. Mm. And it dawned on me that there was a global adaptation because it's all neurological. Yeah. So if you get your legs and your clean, his cleans went up, and it wasn't anything special in the program, it was his squats and his cleans and his plyometrics became so powerful that you're telling me if your legs become extremely powerful, your upper body's not going to get better? And it did. You know, now he was a freak. Now you won't get, that's not normal.
Right,
we get that.
Yeah.
But that dawned on me then, this neurological was so important.
Well, I think it highlights an idea though. So you probably wouldn't get that magnitude.
Right.
But the same idea, you talked earlier this morning about cueing, squeezing your glutes when you bench and finding that the stuff that you're finding is the barbell velocity actually is improved when you focus on squeezing your glutes as hard as you can when you're benching.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. So
the theory is that with hip extension, the right glute pattern or the right pattern for hip extension for your muscles to work is that your glute fires, then the same side hamstring will fire, then the lower back contralateral muscle QL will fire.
Mm-hmm. And so this would be your right glute and then your right hamstring, then your left low back.
Yeah, left low back. Ah. Because your left low back fires because then if you fired your right low back, you'd twist and you'd rotate
turn.
When you walk.
Right.
So But when you see people walk that maybe overstride a little bit, that lean forward, that tells me they got a misfiring pattern in the glute because then their hamstring fires, the right hamstring fires first, then their left QL, lower back, and then their right glute. Mm-hmm. So that's an inverted, that's a backwards pattern there. And then the other pattern I see is that if you have an athlete who, let's say, runs a 400 or does a workout and their back locks up, their QL is the first one to fire. Then their hamstring, and then their glute. So this dysfunctional glute pattern, I actually see it with my athletes. So I watch them run, or I see them do something.
Well, you were watching us walking.
Yeah.
You were rocking around here.
And he fixed Mike's wife walking.
Yeah. I using your butt, girl.
Yeah, so I can pick this
thank
up.
You.
Because, by the way, the patterns, they walk, you know. And ultimately, you're sitting here going, I literally was able to predict one of my athletes. I texted him, said he plays in the NHL, so you're going to have a back problem within a month. Mm-hmm. 2 weeks later, boom, had a back problem.
Yeah.
Because I saw, so when I look at my athletes, I see them run, I see them, I don't look at their numbers. I know who they are by the way they skate or by the way they walk or by the way they run. Well, I could see his pattern, his hip extension when he skates had changed. And when you see that, you know there's a problem.
Yeah.
So he went from being a glute firing pattern to his lower back being the first thing for hip extension, and that's why it locked up. He's like, how'd you know, man? My glutes or my back locks up when I skate. I'm like, well, you got a problem, and it arises.
And when you were
I was going to ask how you assess this, because you see this a lot in CrossFit too, especially in competitions. Now, it could be that a lot of the movements we do, we're just overloading, like pulling patterns, and it just, you know, poor movement over time, it kind of adds up. But at the same time, you see a lot of people in events, they're in this position where, you know, and I know right away because I have a lot of athletes and I've gone through it too, the lumbar is like completely seized up and they are blown up. And I want to know how you would assess that if it is a movement or a firing pattern.
So one of the things you can do on YouTube, I believe, there's plenty of YouTube. You can get on and look at correct hip extension firing patterns, and it'll show you where you basically take your thumb and you can lay the athlete flat on his face and then put and what you'll do is you'll take your thumb and put it on their glute.
Okay.
And take your other finger and put it on their same side hamstring.
So this would be like your right thumb, put it on their right glute, put your right pinky on their right hamstring.
Yep. And then you'd take another finger from your left hand, you put it on the opposite QL.
So the left lower back.
Left lower back, right above the hip in between the lat right there. You can feel that muscle in there. And then when you say pick up your leg, what you'll see is...
So pick up the right leg.
Pick up the right leg.
Back
you'll see the hamstring maybe fire.
Ah.
Or in the CrossFit games when the people... You'll see their lower back fire.
Yeah.
And then the hamstring and then the glute.
Yeah.
So let me talk you through this. If the glute fires first, then all the energy goes down the hamstring, then to the foot so you can run. And then it goes out the upper body.
Okay.
And so if I'm going to push somebody while I'm standing there, if I don't fire my glute, I don't stabilize and I push myself back.
Yeah.
But if I fire my glute, then I can push the person or I can pull the person because I have to fire the opposite leg glute. But so if you have the wrong pattern, so let's say the QL fires the lower back, then the hamstring, notice the energy is going into the body.
Yeah.
That's not good.
Right. And you explode.
And you implode.
Yeah. Implode.
Versus explode. Right. Yeah. You want the glute energy to explode out, so then you run.
See, DePino's about exploding glute energy.
Wasn't that episode one with you, actually?
Yeah, we talked about that, exploding glute energy.
But here's the thing. So you see people walking, and for example, I hate to pick on your wife, but she was walking with her hamstrings, or actually she was, but yet I think she has a lower back is how she fires her glute pattern. So when you do all these prehab exercises, if you are not firing the glute, you're ingraining the wrong pattern again and again. So you actually may be exacerbating a problem.
Yeah. We work on it.
Right. So cueing. Let me give you this example. The one thing that I use people is, let's just talk. One thing I do like to get the glute to fire is I like to curl the big toe. So I tell people, do an RDL.
Wiggle your big toe.
Well, so do an RDL.
I just squeezed my big toe right now and my butt lit up.
Yeah.
So basically what I'm saying is you do an RDL and you hold your big toe up the whole time. This is wrong. So do an RDL, hold your big toe up the whole time. Now I want you to do an RDL. Go down at the bottom, curl your toe, and then do the RDL up. And watch what happens. Your glute fires.
It does. Very nice. I love tricks.
So this is just a
hack. That's a hack.
It's a glute hack.
Hashtag glute hack.
So I'm not sure if it's a natural reflex, but I know if you walk and your foot doesn't grab the ground, it'll slip out from underneath you. So this is why the big toe is very important. Mm-hmm. Now, we hold the toe up on the way down for a number of reasons. It also turns on the psoas, because if you think as you're running and you push the big toe down, why the glute should be extended if your foot's in the back, then you pick your toe up and it helps the psoas turn on then. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
And why does the psoas need to turn on?
To cause hip flexion.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah. So when the hip flexes, so there's another thing. When you see an athlete with big juicy quads, it tells me there might be some glute problems. Or no.
I definitely have
psoas problems.
Psoas problems. So you're exactly right. So then I'll do
because the glutes are or the hamstring or the sorry the quads are doing the work that the psoas is supposed to be doing.
Right. So the quads are supposed to do extension, but when now the quads have to do hip flexion, okay, and not knee extension, then what transpires is the quad now has to over-adapt so it gets bigger. So when I can get the psoas working correctly, whether I do some soft tissue or whatever it may be, then guess what? The quad actually decreases its size. The athlete now jumps and runs faster and jumps higher because it's functioning correctly. Hmm. When the body can do its functions correctly, it functions at a very, very high level.
Right.
So the psoas is very important because – here's the thing. I found that if your breathing pattern's off, so let's talk about sympathetic breathing. When you breathe with your chest, it's a stressful breath, okay?
Sympathetic meaning like when you're exercising.
Well, so if a lion walked through here, we'd all take sympathetic breaths, right?
We'd
take
you
that
would,
chest
not me.
I was going to say that.
I can get to it.
There's lunch, right? Yeah. So, but in my world, I'm like, what I want to do is drive a belly breath, so a parasympathetic breath, so it's a relaxing breath. So, but here's what we found. Actually, Dr. Mike T. Nelson, he explained to me that the fascia from the psoas, the hip flexors, are tied to the diaphragm. So when you breathe wrong, it actually shortens the psoas. Because if all the fascia that's tied to the hip flexor, if you do the right breathing and it causes a relaxation model versus a stressful model, then the psoas can help relax better. Now, here's the catch. If the psoas is shortened and tight, the antagonist to that is the glute.
Yeah.
So the glute shuts down and down-regulates. It doesn't shut off. It just down-regulates.
Sure. Right.
So there's part of the problem. So breathing can be part of the problem, too.
So if a person, you would suggest, like, practicing belly breathing?
The entire time. Mm-hmm. So females, I see, they try to hold the bellies in. That's not good.
It's a little self-conscious.
Exactly. You see what I'm saying?
You mentioned this morning, too, about, so you've done a bunch of different testing. We'll say vertical jump, squat, I mean, all the testing you can do. And what happens when you brace really hard in your stomach and then you try to do those tests? What happened to your numbers?
They all went down. So let me
Not in a good way.
Not in a good way. They all got worse when I say that. If you
Go repeat that again. Yeah.
Cue for the bracing, right?
Right.
When you brace squeeze, your core, brace your core,
big air, push it out. Yeah.
And so what I found that when they run slower. Mm-hmm. When they bench slower. When they do anything, it's not normal. That's not how I truly believe that when you're holding a weight, let's say I'm holding 400 pounds on my back, your body's holding that the way that it should. And if you get the right hip extension pattern, then the body to move that weight will actually turn on correctly the right way throughout. Mm-hmm. So it braces itself the exact amount, nothing more, nothing less. Mm-hmm. But you have to make sure that you have the right patterns going. So that helps.
Right. You're not saying be unstable and totally be loose and out of control. What you're saying is don't get the stability from going through your stomach. Right. Yeah. Get it from squeezing the hell out of your glutes.
Well, start there.
Yes.
And
start
it'll
there.
All kind of it'll go up because you want to get the base of the hips to stabilize.
Right.
And then the whole back stabilizes the right way.
Well, yeah. And a lot of people think that core stability is just your midsection.
No, yes.
It's not. Like it's your glutes, your hamstrings.
Yeah. Yeah. Your knees to chest.
Yeah.
Right.
And a lot of people think that. And you talked about the low back pain. A lot of people think that by doing more core work, that they'll actually get rid of their low back pain when they probably need to activate their glutes more.
Yeah, there's dysfunction. That's why you have the pain.
Right.
Let's be honest. So.
This might open up a whole new wormhole. But what about belts then in training? Because what kind of dysfunction could that create using a belt to be your stabilizer? Because that's what you see is people use that. They push the abs into it. That's what stabilizes.
If they use it all the time, I truly believe that it'll cause the wrong firing pattern, in my opinion.
Interesting.
So, yeah. So I want them to train with lighter loads without the belt as much as possible. Then maybe with the heavy loads, you can not rely on the belt, but you still use your glutes, but then you still want that inner abdominal pressure. So in my opinion, you still have to use it at the high. I mean, I have to. Let's say, if I deadlift 700.
If you're going for a max effort.
Yeah, right. You gotta, for sure.
But if you're just doing just reps while you're
at
training.
500?
Yeah, if you're going
for. Yeah, reps at 500.
Yeah. That's another one of those examples.
Yeah,
I
exactly.
Something
that everyone can do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you're training, you know, y'all talked about hypertrophy. If you're doing, you know, sets of 8 to 10, probably go beltless. Yeah.
Exactly, because in my opinion, you're trying to get that tissue. You're not facilitating the tissue. You want to train the tissue, so you want to get the most out of that. Mm-hmm. So you get a strong core, in my opinion.
Right.
Some of the best core exercise I've seen is, yoke carries. Mm-hmm. I've never seen a world strongman do a 1,000-pound yoke with a weak core.
I've been doing yoke carries for
three months. You said that. Yeah. My favorite core exercise is yoke carries.
Right? Yeah.
That's so awesome.
Well, think about it. If your core's weak, you'll fold like a weak
We did a whole episode on that.
I mean, even the one-arm farmer's carries.
Yeah.
You know?
Yes.
Even if it's strapped, like people are like, well, don't do a strap. Like, well, let's do more weight so then it trains your core. What are you training? Your grip or your core now? So, you know, I like the carries and those things because those are, to me, so actually as a coach, and when I watch an athlete run, I actually look at their midsection. If their midsection's all over the place, so their belly button's moving, I know that the core can't stabilize the leg. Because let's look at the leg. If they're running ahead and the 50-pound or 40-pound limb slams back their leg, it causes huge amounts of rotational force, a couple hundred in a split second. What exercise in a gym do I do to mimic that? Nothing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So what I found is that running tells me a lot. So the same thing if you see the hip shaking, it tells me the SI joint has some dysfunction. Mm-hmm. There's something wrong. You need to send your athlete to a chiropractor soon so they can get things back into place. Mm-hmm. And watch. The chiropractor gets them into place. They come back, and that stuff will probably stop.
Yeah.
Or if it doesn't stop, then they have a weak core. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge indicator or let's say it's dysfunctional, there's some type of pain in there maybe. So, I mean, to me, high-speed running is the best evaluation that I can tell. So for, like, weak hips, let's say lateral movement, like abductors, abduction, what happens is that the foot they'll place when they run at me, the foot actually gets placed right underneath their hips in the middle, when the foot should actually be a straight line when they run and strike.
So the when they're on one foot position, their foot is actually directly underneath their whole body.
Yes.
As opposed to being actually off to the side. Because if I were to do that right now and, say, take my right leg off the ground, I would have to put my foot underneath my center of body to not fall.
And when you're running that way, that tells me you have a weak hips. Mm-hmm. But if that foot is directly underneath the hip socket, then my hips are able to stabilize as this is in the port. So that's an indicator that I got weak hips. Mm-hmm. You know, so then they need to do some abductors exercises to strengthen those. Mm-hmm. I like manual ones where they just get on the bench and just basically, because I can fix them in literally two workouts.
Right. It's kind of like the Trendelenburg test, right? Basically, you pick up one leg and you see if the hips sink, and it tells you if you have some bilateral issues.
But some athletes will pass that. But when there's high force, high velocity running down the track, this tells me that now I can spot it in the one percenters.
Okay.
You know, if they can't function. So to me, that's why running is, again, one of the best functional assessments I can do.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah. So even for non-runners, you would.
Yeah, yeah. It tells me a whole lot about them.
Yeah.
This is a really important point because you see the same thing with speed, strength, or fatigue, right? So especially when you start working into people that train more frequently, so athlete or not, if they're training like an athlete, same thing. If you want to look at movement, you've got to pay attention to what happens, of course, when you tell them, you know, lift your leg up.
Yep.
But someone who's pretty athletic that has good motor control, they can actually get away with it really
cheat.
Well.
Yeah.
They can cheat.
Without.
And sometimes they don't even know that they're cheating.
No.
But what they do when they're not tired is different than when they either get tired or when they move fast or when they move heavy.
Yeah.
And so when you start getting up to someone who's doing a lot of, whether they're an athlete or not, but if they start doing a lot of heavy things, fast things, or things that make them really tired, you've got to assess movement in those environments as well, because that can be completely different.
Yeah.
So that's a good example. You make them move fast, all of a sudden, wow, now I've got hip instability. Yes. Mm. Make me get tired, oh my gosh, now I lose it. Or make it get really heavy, now I see it.
There's a problem,
That's got to be part of your equation. If you're going to invest the time to do a lot of those types of activities, you got to see the danger.
Yeah.
Or the
and
potential.
That's why I just look at running, because I tried a lot of other assessments, and I'd see it, and okay, there's nothing there. But then when they run, I know they got a problem. So I was like, I'm not sure that standing on something telling me that there's a fault in this pattern seems to work. I don't want to mention any names, but you know, you're sitting here, you're going, this assessment doesn't necessarily work at the high end levels for the best athletes. You know, and as my lecture today, I talked about I showed people where there's seven different running dysfunction patterns from the ankle alone. Now, the athletes didn't even know it. So let's say you're running normal and then you sprain your ankle, but you have to keep running. You'll keep running. Your whole gait will change because of that ankle sprain.
You have to compensate. Yeah,
but you don't know it, because what are you running from? Your body just think it's survival.
Right.
You're running from the lion trying to eat you, maybe. That's what you're looking
for.
But you're sitting here going, I see these seven patterns all the time. And through some basic exercises that I put together, and maybe you can post them on the website, I've learned to fix this regards to these seven problems with some basic, simple ankle exercise patterns. Because then, again, as I said this morning, the foot is the only thing that strikes the ground. So the foot and the hip, in my opinion, are the majority of 90% of the knee problems. So if you can make sure the hip's functioning, and then the foot, which strikes the ground, because we ran on air, we probably wouldn't have any knee problems, right? Let's be honest with you.
Oh, yeah. Or we didn't have gravity,
But then when the foot strikes the ground, you probably have some knee problems. And I showed those pictures with seven dysfunctional foot patterns of foot striking. Mm-hmm. And if you can fix those in an athlete or in anybody, then your ability to get rid of knee problems or you get rid of some of these issues that people have when they train are right there with the foot.
So once you've assessed that maybe the athlete has a glute or hip, you know, dysfunction, what are some things specific things that you do? I remember we talked earlier, you cue them. I mean, what are some other things?
Well, so like with the glutes, I often, in all my exercise, I try to cue them.
Yeah, you just tell them, basically.
Yeah, work on firing your glute. Yeah. Squeeze the toe in.
Squeeze the toe in.
You know what I mean?
Because
that seems to turn the glute on, okay? And then with the it's tough. Like, for example, if you do a traditional step up, one of the things that we do is we do our step ups that are straight up and down. So your foot you're stepping up on is not in front of you by two feet or a foot and a half. It's actually right beside your leg when you're standing on the bench. So then, because in sports, all your forces are vertical with your hip and your knee. Mm-hmm. So we actually push straight down.
Yeah.
Okay. Versus pulling yourself forward, because we've never seen in sports that movement. So we always, even at top end speed or running acceleration, your knee and your hip joint are pushing down.
Yeah. You're just leaning.
Yeah. And then the ankle provides you with all the other force.
This is what you were talking about. This step. You were demonstrating this earlier when you do
it. Yeah, but it's his.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it's just still demonstrating.
The traditional way is if you're standing in front of the box, you're pulling with your hamstring rather than
your glute.
And then if you stand to the side of the box and you put your leg on the box, now you have to use your glute
to stand
up.
You're in the right position to fire your glute.
Fire your glute.
You have to consciously think about it, curl your toes down so then the glute fires correctly and everything. All forces are vertical.
I've been doing weighted step-ups and box step-ups wrong my entire life.
Well, it's not wrong. In my lectures, you'll see that I'll actually do a traditional for a while because I'm working on very specific tissue, and then I transfer over to that type of movement because it's more sport-specific.
Would you say the same thing about a split squat or a lunge?
Yes.
So,
my Triphasic 2 book, it's not out yet, hopefully a few months. Basically, what we'll do is we'll do more of the traditional split squat with 120% load. So I actually have
120% of their back squat.
90% of their back squat, but it's a single leg squat now.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
So I have females that'll do they went 130 and they do 315, 320 single leg.
For a split squat.
Safety bar split squat.
Holy shit.
That's strong.
And then I mean, you should see my throwers though. So you got throwers doing 700 pounds on split squat. That's scary.
That is pretty scary.
That's a lot.
But it's safe.
like a rear foot elevated? No, actual foot stance?
What I'll do, I found that I like rear foot elevated at the lower loads, but the high loads, I actually found that there's a little bit of hip problems. Yeah. So the SI pops out maybe.
Yeah.
So with 700 pounds.
That doesn't sound good.
Pops out, maybe. A lot of stress and hip extension on the back leg too, right?
Again, I've cracked a few eggs. So I first started with these heavy loads, and our chiropractor on a Monday goes, hey, all their SIs, something's wrong. I said, I don't know what it is, but I'll fix it. Right?
I don't know what happened.
I don't know. Right.
They must have been not drinking or something.
Maybe my GA did something. Yeah. I don't know.
So I keep heavy loads. I keep the foot on the ground. But then lighter loads, I'll actually go rear foot elevated.
Okay.
And then, you know, so you're sitting here, you're going, then I get into more specific stuff. So my split squat will actually be more up and down. So the knee goes forward in front of the toes. Because that, I can show you hundreds of pictures where the knee is in front of the toes in sports all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So then that's what we get to, the more sport specific stuff.
Okay.
Because I've never actually found an athlete in a power lifting squat position.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, right. You're basically saying like the hips back, vertical shin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you're training athletes.
You're training athletes
to move and compete at a high level. Like, you want to train them.
Specific.
Right.
And I mean, sports specificity is so scary. A friend of mine, Hank Krajinoff, he was a world-class track coach. He talked about his athlete, Nelly Cuminati. She always won second in the 100 in the Worlds and the Olympics. She always won the indoor 60-meter world championships. But she always got caught by somebody.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he talked about how he changed her. He analyzed her race, took the first 50 and the second 50, timed it out. Then he had her start training with 120s, maybe 150s for speed endurance, which makes sense. Everyone agreed.
Yeah. Right.
Well, guess what? He actually did make her 2/10 faster in the first 50.
Yep.
But by doing all that 150 training, made her 3/10 slower
on the
first 50. So that's how specific sports is when you get to the high level.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what you have to mimic and be aware of. That's just an example of specificity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's scary, the thoughts of that.
We had a similar thing happen with the UFC fighters that I work with, where they were fighting 3 5-minute rounds. And they would love to spar 4 or 5 or up to 10 5-minute rounds. And their idea was, well, okay, when I get to my end of my third round, I want to know that I still have a whole round left in the tank.
Mm-hmm.
The problem was your pacing for 7 5-minute rounds is totally different than your pacing for 3.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had a problem. They'd go out in the first round, and they started getting just smashed because they weren't used to the pacing of that 5-minute round.
Yeah.
So we actually started having them do things like, no, you're going to do 3 3.5-minute rounds.
Yeah.
And I want you to be exhausted at the end because I want you to know what pace you can actually run people through.
Mm-hmm.
And I want you to feel. And so as they get closer to camp, now probably the last 4 weeks before their fight,
mm-hmm.
they don't do anything in their sparring besides 3 5-minute rounds.
And would you see?
Not doing 6-minute rounds. They're not doing 5.5-minute rounds. They are doing 3 5-minute rounds out. I want you to feel exactly what that's going to feel like.
Yeah. And would you see some athletes that adapted faster than the others when it came to that?
Absolutely.
Like some of them would need more time to kind of ramp up for that sport-specific training, and then some could give them 2 weeks almost, and they're ready to go.
I think that has to do with your genetic markers and the various type. It's definitely genetics. Some of my athletes, they can peak in 2 weeks, and that we found that that's optimal. And then 6 weeks out, they actually start to decline.
Right.
But then other athletes need 6 weeks out to peak optimally. And again, that's genetics. That's a whole nother ball of wax.
A lot of it's your training background, too, versus your training age.
Training age.
So one of the things we always say is a high-level athlete is not highly trained. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have to be. Mm-hmm. You can be highly skilled, not highly trained, or vice versa. Just because you're 22, you may have the training body of a 28-year-old, or vice versa. Yes. So that all was determined.
Yeah.
Got to determine it.
And when we talked earlier, you use a thing device to like measure kind of the stress and that's effect on, I guess. Adaptation.
The athlete. Yeah.
So when to know when to push and when to not.
Right.
Yeah. So, I mean,
what is that? What is
that?
Output?
Yeah. I want to dive into that a little
bit.
Yeah.
What's that?
So I have I have a heart rate variability device. I use the Omega Wave. There's plenty of good ones out there. But ultimately, when you're looking at this and you really want to get to the most specific in-season stuff where you may have an athlete who comes in who's fatigued, if you train him hard in the in-season, you may affect his training or his ability to learn skill for the next week because you trained him in a fatigued state. Mm-hmm. So when he's in-season, you actually want him to – you maybe instead of doing a hard workout, you may do a recovery workout, which might be light bodybuilding. It might be a light flush bike workout to get him recovered so he can train hard tomorrow.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Do you see the difference?
Yeah.
So now you've only lost one day of training versus – 6 good days of pushing him when he's super fatigued. Right. Mm-hmm. And I think people have taken this out of context because I'm sitting here going, in season, that's great because I need this kid to perform. But when it's in the off season, I still want to train. Kids will come in. I'm guaranteeing you the second week of my off season training, day 10 of training, which would be Wednesday, Thursday and Friday, their readings are horrible. But I'm going to push them for 2 weeks.
What is this reading again? Okay.
This is heart rate variability. Okay. This is the neurological system, the DC potential coming out, the brain waves coming out of the body or the brain. So it measures a number of things, and it just tells me whether they're fatigued. In a gross overview, it tells me whether they're fatigued, where their state of physiology is. Mm-hmm. Okay, so an athlete's just traveled, and I'll actually do this with a number of pros where I follow them during the season, and you can see, hey, what happened last night? Oh, I flew home at 3 in the morning. Well, you can see that
talk
there was
to my
a
ex-wife.
Yeah, right. Well, the story about should I explain that one?
Yeah.
Well, what transpired was I had an athlete who was on ESPN. He'd probably done some things. I know he did things he shouldn't. He was in national news.
In trouble. Good news.
No, not good news. It was in trouble.
Getting embarrassed in
All-Star weekend. Yeah. Made it rain up in there. Had too much fun.
Yeah. Just say 24 years old going to Vegas and you're a millionaire is probably pretty fun.
So I thought he'd be stressed. So this machine tests his stress levels. Mm-hmm. There was nothing. I went, how is this possible? And I asked him, I said, dude, you good? He's like, I don't care what's going on. It doesn't bother me. Well, a week later he comes in, highest stress levels I've ever seen. He just got off the phone with his ex-wife, right?
So bitch.
How does national news affect you at the stress levels? Not affect you because you don't care.
You don't care.
So it's really the organism's interpretation of stress. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? And then the state at which they're in. So if you've got an athlete that's really in shape, he can handle. He'll be less stressed because of all this stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But if he's out of shape and he does a workout, it can affect him even worse.
Yeah.
And if he hates the workout is another thing. Like one of the things, and I'll be honest with you, I truly feel that aerobic base is of vital importance. Let me give you this example. My son who snuck in, he had a fun gym class workout with a personal trainer in town I set up. There was a bunch of kids. Then he went to his mom's hockey camp and skated for 2 hours. And then he snuck into the older kids' camp. So he's in 5 hours in the workout. Then he goes home. I didn't think he had a good lunch. He was 8 now. Mm-hmm. He goes to the neighbors and swim for 4 hours. We call over. He runs home, lays on the floor. I'm going to test him because I know he's shot, right?
Yeah. I got to know.
Right? And he's an Olympic-level athlete. I'm telling you, it's 6 to 7 days with the readings I got. He was so bad. In a 2-minute test, he fell asleep. Now, you talk about nutrition. He didn't
So 2 minutes. He sat there for 2 minutes and
immediately
fell asleep.
He didn't even eat dinner. We sent him right to bed. He didn't want to eat.
Yeah.
He was so tired. I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to test him in the morning. We're going to see how bad and how long it takes him to recover. Right?
I know it's going to be,
you
too.
See what I mean?
Science dad.
Ready?
Good luck.
Because my Olympic caliber athletes or anybody else is 7 days and they're done.
If 7 days.
To recover.
To recover.
Before they get back to normal status.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
That is a long time.
Longer than people think.
Yeah.
And so then I test him in the morning, and he's good. And I went, what the
heck? You made a freak, man. You made
Well, you're sitting here, you're going, no, he's not. He can't be, right? So I call around, and really, basically, the kids have such a great aerobic system for survival of the organism that their aerobic base is so good if they're active.
Right.
They heal from a lot. Now, the other thing
How old is he, too?
He was 8 then.
Okay.
Right?
8 years old.
But okay, so he hasn't hit puberty yet. Yeah, so I want to know what kind of cereal he's eating.
But here's the other factor you have to realize. You watch a busload of 25-year-olds go by in the campus, and they look like they're going to the morgue. I mean, they got bills, people got jobs.
Yeah.
You see a busload of 8-year-olds.
Yeah.
They're having fun.
Yeah.
There's no external stress.
Right.
So even though you don't think your life's stressful, it's still stressful. Yeah. And your ability to recover. Yeah. Now, even my pro athletes, I mean, they work out harder than they go golf, but they still have relationship issues. They still have all these. My son, nothing bothers him.
He ain't got
no
credit card debt.
So he doesn't have to worry about it. So really, again, this is all part of the formula.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at this and how hard an athlete can train
and
where you can get to. So then, as we said before, 6 months of training or 8 weeks of training, you might not be able to repeat that with the athlete again because there's other variables in there. And which worked great last time may not work great this time. That's why to get the high levels, you need to monitor.
Would you say that – yeah, I was going to ask you, would you say just for like a normal person, would you say that they need to be able to like monitor and measure their stress levels? Or is that important?
I think it is, but you know what? Once you start educating the people and you can really assess yourself, you know where your stress levels are at. So if you're in the workout and you say, I don't have it today – don't be afraid to back down today.
Yeah.
Go a little lighter. You can even do the same workout.
That
just go
huge.
A little wider.
Yeah.
Maybe even make it aerobic. And when I say that,
so
just keep your heart rate below 140
and
do the same workout, lighten the load, reduce the rest, make it more of a circuit versus a hard interval workout. And then guess what? You're ready to go the next day versus killing yourself and you might be ugly for, you know, in poor shape for 3 days before you recover.
That's a huge thing I've learned in the past, you know, 6 months or so. Like, if you don't feel it that day, it's just not that day to you. Do something, you know, very light, and you'll be ready the next day or the next day.
Especially when the calories are coming down.
Yeah.
Right? And the food restriction comes in. That makes things even worse. If you
have
to take a gallon of C4 to get through a strength workout, like,
that's a good point.
Probably not.
I say that with a lot of my clients, especially when they come back from sickness. They're like, man, am I ready to come back tomorrow? And I'm like, you probably could, but you're going to be at 90%, and that's going to keep you at 90% for 5 more days. Yeah. Let's just take 1 more day off, maybe 2. And then that's only 2 days off that you missed, and now we can be back at 100% for sure. So that patience coming back. Yeah. And I think the biggest thing I just took from that on the stress levels was really understanding what an impact daily stressors have, especially for you adults listening that are doing a ton of high-intensity training.
Yes.
You've got to take that stuff into consideration.
Well, I bought a $20,000 laptop. Didn't tell my wife I was doing it right. Which caused a lot of stress.
You didn't bench 400. You didn't pull 700 that day.
and, you know, she sees it on the credit card. And then I get the thing, and it's a heart rate variability device. You're going, okay. She's like, okay, what's it do? And I said, well, I don't know yet.
Makes us money, babe. You ever put it on your wife?
Oh, yeah.
Did you put it on her that day?
Actually, no, she didn't want anything to do with it for a while. But my point is I'm sitting here going, once I start talking to the athletes and I realize I was able to kind of predict what this machine was going to tell me by when they walked in, I could see if their gait was changed. Because if they have slumped shoulders, they'll be more tired, okay? Mm-hmm. It tells me they're more tired. Their eye function, as they're talking to me, if they take longer to explain what's going on with them, there's something wrong. So if they're not their self, now the human, like a coach, sees this.
Yeah.
And you can go, holy buckets, I don't tell my wife, hope she's not going to listen, but I didn't need the laptop maybe anymore. But my point is that I can pick up these cues.
Yeah.
So then you as a person, the normal person, could say, okay, I just did this normal warm up. I'll give it a couple more sets. But if it ain't there, back down, you know? Because what people don't realize is when you're in those states, in my opinion, little things pop up. You tweak something because you're not functioning correctly.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
And that go ahead.
If it's taking you 10 extra minutes to do a stretch that normally didn't take that long, like that's a sign.
That's a sign. Yeah.
And that's so huge because if you can recognize that, you're not going to tell yourself, like, don't be stop being a pussy. Like, you need to go.
Yeah.
And maybe there's some times where that is appropriate, but like if you're training, that's different.
Yeah, I find weightlifting is actually one weird one because I can't tell you how many days that that I'd go in and you know you're snatching and you're like, my God, the bar feels
can't lift
so heavy
60%.
But then you PR that day.
Right.
You're like, what?
Right.
Like the bar feels so heavy. Mm-hmm. So I think you hit it on the head right there really well is you got to pay attention to it. Sometimes you have to push through.
Yeah.
But I think the only thing you're really going to know is years of training,
mm-hmm.
and times of training.
Yeah.
And you have to play with things a lot and get more experience to find it because it is difficult. Sometimes you don't feel good after set one, but by set five, you're like, oh, actually, I feel pretty good today.
Yeah. Sorry, Andy.
No, I was going to say,
I feel like we didn't even talk.
I know.
Like, Andy, what you been up to, dude?
Well, you mentioned that earlier, Kyle, and part of your talk, too, is the off-season aspect about how you have a little bit more space to play with that. I'm not saying you're intentionally trying to, like, hurt anyone or, like, run your athletes down, but you can the super compensation was the question, where in the off-season, that is kind of when you're trying to maybe overtrain them a little bit so they can bounce back more often.
No, I actually overtrain them a lot in the off-season.
I didn't want to put words in your mouth.
No, please. No,
you didn't hear me at all right.
And this is like legit overtraining, not like, oh, I'm so tired. And
But here's the deal. Like, if you can't push the ceiling limits of the organism, you can only do that by taking them to extremely high levels of adaptation. You know, so I'll push them. I go 2 week cycles and I may take 5 days off or four and I go another 2 week cycles. But you're sitting here going, I push them to the highest level. So, for example, in triphasic at the isometric phase, I actually see, and I don't do any conditioning during this period. I've actually had from my interns, which I make them go through the program, okay, to my
it's
elite
like hazing
athletes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
They need to understand it, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I see in 2 weeks, I see a 12 beat resting heart rate drop. So they'll go from maybe 50 to 38, and they're doing no conditioning because the isometric phase.
Which is really good, by the way.
Because the isometric phase, when they're holding that weight in the bottom position. Now, I do actually have them hold their breath in there. The only rule is you can't pass out. Mm. Okay. but what happens is there's huge vascular adaptation because the blood pressure goes through the roof. But then all this vascular adaptation that takes place causes huge amounts of so then your blood pressure drops actually.
Yep.
Your resting heart rate is super low, but then when you go to crank it up, you can actually crank it up to higher levels because I call that your functional reserve. So your low level resting heart rate is important, and then when you can push it high and go longer at the highest levels, that's actually your window of stress is so much greater than somebody that's out of shape whose resting heart rate's at 90 and then can only get to 160 and then they shut it down after 30 seconds, where my elite athlete will have a resting heart rate of 38, 42, and they can go up to lactate threshold at 185, 190 for 2.5 minutes.
You know, I don't know if you're even aware of this study, and you might be, but there's a really one of my favorite studies to reference is blood pressure, and the only training that they did is was six weeks long. Was a 6 second maximal grip strength hold. And they did six of those.
It's my favorite test in the world.
I know, I was going to say.
They did it like 3 or 4 times a day, but it was hold for 6 seconds, you know, 10 second break or whatever, 6 reps of that, 3 or 4 times a day, and saw anywhere between 15 to 20 millimeters of mercury drop in systolic and diastolic blood pressure.
Yes.
That was the whole thing.
Yep.
The only training program. So your 7 second hold, I'm not surprised when you start seeing those adaptation
that.
Because you put a, and I always get this question after I say that is, what the hell, how is that possible? You put a tremendous blood pressure stress on the body during isometric portion. So this can be when you're bracing during a squat or in your case, holding at the bottom with whatever your deadlift. What happens is so much of your musculature is contracting at the same time that blood flow effectively stops. It's called occlusion.
Mm-hmm.
Right, it effectively stops going anywhere, and so your heart, right out of the ventricle that comes out of your heart that gets the blood throughout your entire body, the pressure in that area gets so incredibly
high.
It gets so incredibly high because it's not moving blood, and the system is telling it, you got to move blood, you got to move blood, and so we'll see blood pressures, and this has been shown at least a half a dozen times. Blood pressure is as high as 480 over 350.
Holy shit.
Normal blood pressure is 120 over 80.
How does your heart not explode?
Yeah. Right? Now, this is only, though, for a few seconds.
Right.
Of course,
right.
This is, you're not doing this for an hour or even more than a minute. You know, this is a few seconds. So you can get a tremendously high blood pressure. And what that then does is it gives your body the stimulus that says, we have got to improve capillary density, which means we have to
almost died. I mean,
exactly, like right? Basically. We've got to do something that improves blood flow. So that means make my arteries and vesicles more plastic, make them able to expand more. Mm-hmm. I will grow more, go through angiogenesis, grow more capillaries, which will improve blood flow into your tissue and get waste out. All of that can happen with
Yeah.
A little bit. So these amazing cardiovascular adaptations from a 5 to 7 second isometric heavy hold.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right? A new type of aerobic training.
Yeah. And it's not.
So when he says that, he's not full of shit. I've
noticed that, like doing sets of, yeah. I used to do a lot, like Travis would program 7 second pauses in the bottom and 15 second pauses at the top. Yeah. And I was doing that for a while and doing like sets of 10, you know, things like that. Yeah. And I just, out of curiosity, like I wanted to test my 400 and 800, and it wasn't too bad. It wasn't great, but I mean, for a weightlifter who had never done that stuff, like I didn't have any problems breathing.
Right.
So,
right.
I mean, just not handle doing any kind of aerobic work.
With the greater vascular adaption, you can move substrates around.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Even more efficiently. So you actually get, you're in greater shape without having to try to be in greater shape, is what I'm saying. Yeah. So, I mean, and then your recoverability is even greater per set and per workout.
Removing waste.
Yes, right. Exactly.
What you said earlier, too, about how you were such a proponent of having an aerobic base.
Yeah,
I would fully agree with you, and I don't think anyone that thinks through this would disagree, but what people don't understand is that doesn't mean you're saying you should run for an hour.
Right.
You're saying you should have an aerobic base. Now, this is one way to get to that base, and there's a million other ways. So you need to have that vasculature. You need to have the mitochondria density. You need to have these transporters. That doesn't mean you have to hop on the elliptical for an hour. You can. It certainly will be effective. But the aerobic base needs to be there, but now we have to talk maybe in another episode of how to get that aerobic base.
Yeah, how do you do it? Man. Like, the one thing came from my world-class shop putters, they need an aerobic base so they can do more sets. I found if they were more aerobic set, they could do 12 sets of bench versus 8 before they dropped off. So the question is, how do I do that without running 5 miles with these 300-pound men? And it was as simple. Honestly, I came up with this, and I know there's some NFL teams using it now. I would just take 50% of squat, front squat, 50% of your bench.
Oh, this is brutal.
And you do singles on bench, do a single bench, front squat, single, one rep, back and forth for 8 minutes. Your heart rate's at 140, 150, but you're still getting strong and getting some hypertrophy by building an aerobic base and not ruining the athlete by running 5 miles.
Yeah.
So there's all these variabilities.
Sounds like strength endurance work.
Yeah.
That's fascinating. I wish I could. I think I'm going to build my aerobic base
What was that? Like squat, bench? What was that again?
Yeah, just take two exercises, squat and bench. Go back and forth. Do singles, one rep at a time. Keep your heart rate below your lactate threshold. So my athletes that I know.
Yeah, the important point. You're not trying to burn down the gas. You're not puffing and puffing. You're just moving.
You're just moving. Go back and forth. Don't stop. Keep it below. Like if I have lactate threshold at 170, some of my athletes, I say below 165. And you stay there and you keep going singles for 8 minutes. Yeah. So what's the difference between an athlete running for 8 minutes at 160 or lifting weights? There is no difference for the heart. Right. It's the same movement. It's the same thing.
It's stressing the body.
If you think, you know, aerobic exercise, what does the word aerobic mean?
With oxygen.
Okay, aerobic with oxygen.
Good job, Alex.
All you got it, right? That means all you have to do to get an aerobic stimulus is use oxygen. It doesn't matter what you're doing, right? You want to say, I'm going to do cardio. What's cardio mean? Cardio means heart. Okay, so anytime you're using your heart, you're doing cardio.
Okay, you do cardio right now.
Is that easy enough, right? You need to do something that slightly elevates your heart rate and that has an aerobic component. In other words, you can breathe. And the mode can be extremely different. You talked about that earlier, too, of changing the mode based on adherence, right? So you said one of the more important aspects or helpful things you found with programming is giving the athlete the exercise they like. They'll do it more often. You'll get better results. It won't be as stressful.
Yeah. Right.
And so to hell with what you think. It's about what they like and give them that.
A lot of strength athletes will fight, like, why am I doing cardio and stuff? But like you said earlier, was that it allows them to go like longer sets or do more sets with quality reps. Because if you're fatigued, your technique goes away. Right. Your technique drops and you can't.
It's pretty simple. Yeah. If I have an athlete I'm speed training, he can only do six 40s before he slows up, or he can do 12. Who's going to get faster? Which one?
Right.
But you need some level of aerobic base to repeat those. And it's called repeated sprintability. Sure. Do you see what I'm saying?
Because the aerobic base helps that recover between sets.
And that's why I've had some awesome deals.
Thank you. Right. Yes.
Yeah. Well, it's validation to this Mike McElroy, who listens to this, who's on this podcast too. He will be like, thanks, Dave.
Yes.
Right. I've actually been fortunate. I wrote a tactical magazine or a tactical manual, and like the tactical operators gave it to their wives, and they're actually getting benefit from it. Mm-hmm. Also, because it's basically the same workout. If you want to do the same workout during the whole week, you can. But one of the days, first day, you're under 10 seconds. The next day, you're between 20 and 30 seconds of high intensity. Mm-hmm. And then the next day, you can do the same exercises, but you're doing them light and a lot of reps, mm-hmm. and it never stops. So it's more of a circuit. So you get a lactate training, mm-hmm. alactic training, yep. short mm-hmm. sprints. You get lactate training. And then you get aerobic training, mm-hmm. and it's like
with the exact same exercises every time.
Yeah, or you can switch it up. Either yeah, yeah, or, yeah. but it, keep it simple. So I'm just sitting here, and people have actually taken that and put CrossFit model in there. So they push a heavy sled for 10 seconds, mm-hmm. and then they go to let's say a heavy, let's say a deadlift, mm-hmm. like a hex deadlift. Then and the other days they're doing kettlebell swings on those. So they replace out the exercise based upon the intensity of the mm-hmm. day. So it's either short 10-second duration, it's 20 to 30 seconds in duration, or it's continuous exercise. And they think like right. cardio. No, it can be a weightlifting circuit. It doesn't right. matter mm-hmm. what it is. Yeah. You see
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So
as that's long as long as I wanted to go back to you explaining some of the, you know, in CrossFit world, they would call it EMOMs, basically. Like you said, for 8 minutes, you would do a heavy pull and then maybe a heavy squat or something, go yeah. back and forth. And the important thing there was to keep the percentages down, or at least your heart rate low enough to where it was submaximal.
Yeah, so you're below your lactate threshold.
Okay, so like what percentages are we looking at on something like that? So if somebody
usually
wants to try this.
Usually standard 80 or 70 your lactate threshold.
No, you're saying for the weight.
For the load.
Yeah. For the heart rate? Okay, so the load was roughly about 50%.
Okay.
So then I stay below your lactate threshold. So people can figure that out. So if your lactate threshold is estimated at 165, then you can monitor with a heart rate. So you can do one single bench, go back to front squat, do that, mm-hmm. keep going back and forth, and you can keep going until your heart rate gets about 160. And you may need to take a little bit more rest, mm-hmm. but you drop to 150, go do the lift, and then come back. So you're just holding that heart rate there.
If you don't know your lactate threshold, you can take a little more of an applied approach, yeah. where one, you can just stick with about 150, 160, yeah. 170 if you're fairly fit. Mm-hmm. If you're not,
your heart rate.
Right.
Yeah.
but that's probably going to be most people. You're going to be yeah. between the 150, 160, yeah. 170 range. If you're really, really highly trained, mm-hmm. maybe that number's higher.
Yeah.
So if you don't know your exact lactate threshold, that will still put you in the ballpark. But the point is, for this particular adaptation, for what you're trying to get out of this program, it's supposed to be fairly easy.
Yeah.
Right? You shouldn't be gassing. You shouldn't be throwing up after this workout. If you mm-hmm. are, you probably crossed the threshold. Now,
yeah.
there's times for that. You're not saying not do that, but for this adaptation, for this exercise.
Yeah.
Got
I'd
it.
Say 120 to 150, 52, 55 yeah. Yeah. is a good rule. You could stay. Anybody could stay in there.
And
even my mom.
Would this be? Would this be part of your kind of your triphasic, or is it kind of a separate thing?
That would be the weekly sequence. That's actually to get people in shape. So that I would use
So before triphasic.
So triphasic is a true off-season program. Mm-hmm. I do it in season, but small amounts. But triphasic is essentially an off-season. You're gonna get rocked. Yeah. You know, but mm-hmm. a very specific get rocked to increase human performance.
And you've seen this work on what types of athletes? Power athletes, endurance athletes?
Endurance, power lifters. I've had some power lifters email me, set some world records this year. Sprinters, mid-distance runners, football players, hockey players. So
wide variety of energy systems.
Yeah.
Energy systems and or it remodels the tissue, so you actually mm-hmm. tissue is more resilient, so you're less likely to get hurt, mm-hmm. but you can also perform well, because once you get through triphasic and then do your sport specific stuff, mm-hmm. you just see the results post triphasic.
I'm glad we came back to this, because I also wanted to ask you, what about training age and experience? When would you have someone use this strength program?
So I just released a high school football manual, and I have high school coaches just email me. One sent me an email, says he's got 30 kids over 30 inch verticals.
Wow.
With triphasic, 16, 17. Now, they're 150 pounds, right?
Right.
And then the original guy that I wrote it with was Chris Corfus. He called me and said, Cal, I'm using the triphasic program with some of this ankle rocker stuff that you saw today.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he's like, I got 6 36-inch verticals. I'm like, send me a video. These kids were doing vertical jump with their hands on their hips and jumping 36 inches.
That's huge.
And I went, that's like a 40 with other people, right?
Oh, yeah.
Now, I had another coach that sent me an email, said I got 30-inch verticals. But here's the deal. Triphasic makes your hips and knees strong. And when you can make the ankles extremely functional, so your hips and knee push up, and then the ankles are the last thing that push, you can
A
dysfunctional ankle can reduce your vertical by 6 inches, I'm telling you right now. And if you can make a extremely highly functional ankle that's very strong and powerful with the ankle rocker stuff in that manual that we do, what you can do is you can add 3 to 6 inches on your vertical. Because it's just it's like I use this. If you have a shot putter, he can throw it 70 feet. But if he tapes up his wrist and he can't, he loses 20 feet off his shot.
As if that's acting as like an ankle of the upper body.
But you're not that strong. So the shot put actually when he goes to snap his wrist is only a few ounces because he's accelerated. It's not 16 pounds.
Sure, sure.
So you've accelerated the body with your hip and knee. Mm-hmm. And then the calf is the final push-off.
So not only when you jump hard, but your endurance, I'm sure. So if you're doing a bunch of repetitions or running, I guarantee your endurance, or you would probably guarantee anyways.
I guarantee because you're more functional. And it takes less energy to do what you're doing.
Right.
You see what I mean? Yeah. So it's pretty simple. If the human organism can function at high levels and you get all these compensation patterns, you get all these problems fixed, it does magical stuff in my opinion.
A lot of the people probably listening aren't in a traditional sports season, so they don't have an off-season, post-season, in-season, that type of stuff. It's kind of
year-round.
They might have a competition.
We're working on that.
getting there. So how would or would it at all the triphasic apply to people who are just working out for health and longevity?
So let's say you want to try triphasic. What I would do is in a CrossFit model, maybe?
Well, whatever. Whatever model. I mean, someone who listens, they don't
Well, CrossFit competitor, but then also just general CrossFitter who's not doing competition, not peaking for the open.
So so maybe you're just going to do a couple strength days a week. You could literally add triphasic into your normal lifts, whether it may be whether it's an RDL, whether it's the deadlift, whether it's a bench or a squat. And then you could do CrossFit on the other days, but you could just add the eccentric phase for 2 weeks to get rid of, help get rid of strengthen your tendons and your joints, and then add the isometric phase. And isometric is always done at the weakest position. It's brutal. You know what I mean? It's ugly.
Give me an example again.
Well, like the bottom of the bottom of the bench press.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
So would this vary? But for everybody, you could say weakest position. Like some people.
Well, no, everyone's weaker at the bottom usually. Okay. At the very bottom, you know. Okay. What I mean? Yeah, you might have sticking points through there that are different. But ultimately, you know, and then you could do that, and really you could cut triphasic down to 4 weeks, two eccentrics, two iso, and then you're just getting into your normal training. So, so really it's a two-week series of very specific stress that causes the body to adapt to make you healthier, and you can even train more maybe later.
Yeah, where would just start over.
Yeah,
you start the phase
start
over.
And
where
would
the positions be for the other? So
like
that's my bench. Where would my squat? Where would my say RDL?
Your squat would be at the bottom position. Yeah,
very bottom
your
for you.
RDL is always in a stretch position down below the knees. Yeah. So I mean, I have big throwers grab 450 RDL down below the knee and hold it for 3 seconds or five, and then come back up. Now they're very strong. Mm-hmm. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. And then you can do whatever position you want, whatever exercise you want, but most people just starting out just use the big exercises and see the difference.
Yeah. So basically when the muscle's at its longest point,
yes,
when it's stretched out the furthest.
Because it also remodels the muscle in that deepest position.
Yeah. Okay. Is this when you apply this to a lot of clients, athletes, have you seen an injury rate decrease?
Yes. Decrease. I've seen it as much high school kept track and they said they dropped 70%.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so they only had 30%
And if you're
injuries.
A strength coach, that's a big thing.
Oh,
big
my gosh.
That's your job.
And if you're a coach, if you got healthy athletes, you got more people in the game.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Right. That's big. To just say, if you can walk in with the day one and then have the last day of the season with the same level of athletes that you have and they're healthy, then you're probably going to win a few more games, let's be honest.
And would you say this is definitely something that maybe people would want to try? So many people always ask, like, why have I plateaued? Like,
yes, of course.
Yeah.
Because really you're getting new tissue, and when the tissue is thicker and more dense, then what happens is your strength limitations by the Golgi tendon apparatus is because your tendon's thicker, now it doesn't register as much, so your inhibitors are actually downregulated a little bit. Through
and this is hypertrophy. I mean, what you're talking about.
With all tissue, not just muscle, but the tendons.
The tendons, and a lot of people don't think, a lot of people don't equate hypertrophy to the connective tissue.
Yes,
that, but that's a lot of the old power lifters, like the tendon strength is like huge.
Yeah. Premium. It's the same thing, honestly, with strength.
Yeah.
So people want to give the central nervous system all the credit for strength or all the blame for their lack of strength. Right? Yep. My central nervous system wasn't ready to go. Well, that's part of it.
I didn't take enough C4. Come on.
Muscle contraction works off of three things. Number one, you have to have some input from the central nervous system. This would be your brain, lower brain stem, and spinal cord. Then it has to actually cause the muscle to contract. Then muscle actually, and people don't realize this, muscle doesn't cause movement. Muscle just pulls on connective tissue.
Right.
Connective tissue attaches to bone. Yes. That's what pulls movement. Mm-hmm. And so step number one, central. Step number two, muscle. Step number three, connective tissue. Mm. And if I'm not ready in all three of those things, I mean, we've seen, we were talking about Bill Casimir earlier.
Yes.
Right? How do you rip a tendon off of the bone? Right? Well, if I'm not ready to go at all three levels, if I have my connective tissue isn't at the same level of my muscle, we're going to have injury there. It's going to be whatever's weakest is going to absorb the pain.
Yep.
Right? And so now all of a sudden, God, I got elbow tendonitis.
There's a weak leak somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And so we need to train all these things, and we need to have the connective tissue ready. Mm-hmm. This is connective tissue that is also surrounding the individual muscle fibers. Mm-hmm. So each individual muscle cell has connective tissue around it. Mm-hmm. Those are bundled together. That has connective tissue around it. Mm-hmm. That whole thing is bundled together. We call that big ass bundle a muscle. Mm-hmm. That's all wrapped around it. And that comes together to make what's called a tendon. That's exactly what tendons mm-hmm. are.
Yeah.
And then those things attach at a very, very little point to a bone. If you look at your quadriceps, yeah. here's a good example. All four of your massive quadriceps, those huge muscles come together into one tendon. Mm-hmm. They cross over
yep.
your kneecap, and it's a small little tendon that attaches to what's called your tibial tuberosity, the very front of your tibia. All of your quadriceps mm-hmm. attach with this much area.
Yeah.
And so now all of the force in my 700-pound squat, or 100-pound squat, yeah. wherever we're at, has to be transmitted, and it's all inserted on the exact small
this
little location.
Little bit, yeah.
right? This
yeah.
is our classic example of Osgood Slaughter's, right?
Yes.
That disorder. We have issue there. So my point with all that is, yeah, we have to have some training, and maybe that means we have to go slow for a few weeks of the year. Mm-hmm. Because we have to build sufficient muscle, connective tissue, and of course the strength and power and speed stuff will help the nervous system.
Yeah.
But that stuff, the connective tissue has to be trained as well. And the eccentric stuff you brought up is critical.
It
to that
sounds
stuff.
Like the same principles on a really good gymnastics strength training program, right? You yes. start with the isometrics, but only difference with upper body is that your body weight is enough to
sure.
to produce that kind of stress. Yeah. You can't do that with the lower body. So that's why it's you would have loading yeah. Yeah. with yeah. barbells yeah. and yep. things like that.
Exactly.
Depending on your level.
And it sounds like too, this style of strength training would also be very good for somebody who didn't want to necessarily eat a whole bunch and they want to get stronger because the easiest way is stronger,
get bigger
right? Yeah, right, so like if you want to stay the same size
if you don't want to take the easy route
would you
I was gonna say one caveat to this that you want to be careful with: anytime you start adding a bunch of eccentric work, you're gonna probably get really sore really fast. Mm-hmm. So if you've never done anything like this, don't just go I'm gonna do eccentric everything, hold for 10 seconds, I'll do 15 reps, 20 sets of every exercise I do. You're gonna be crushed.
It's extremely stressful.
So where would you, if someone wants to try this Monday,
try 2 or 3 sets of your main lifts.
Okay.
You know, and ultimately one thing I do is I tell my athletes to eat more Jello because of the collagen and the beef tendons. Yeah. So that has a lot of the nutrients, right? Or you can do fried chicken or bone broth, the whole deal. But so actually, when my third, fourth book comes out, every specific stress in my system has a food or supplement that would back it to help you heal from the stress.
Well, that's a terrible idea.
Yeah.
That's another strength.
So it's like so I do have supplements that match up with the system. Mm-hmm. So when you look at this system, you can see how the various stressors have been identified, and then you can actually take the supplements that help you support or not support the system based upon your needs of training.
Right.
What the?
Sorry about that. A butterfly.
Just see that bat?
Yeah.
Austin apparently has like natural bats everywhere.
Yeah. Oh,
natural
wow.
bats.
Yeah,
like
it was
unnatural
a butterfly,
bats.
But whatever.
Guys, we're getting close to a little over an hour. Kyle, we want to be conscious of your time. I know you've got more talking to do. You've probably talked for like 8 hours straight today. So I learned a lot. Thank you very much for coming on. Real quick though, where can we find more information about you? What books?
Yeah, my main website is xllikeextralargeathlete.com, and I have
like
my books.
That's
awesome.
Yeah,
that's so awesome. So simple.
My book.
Why didn't we buy that?
Mike has it. He tried.
Yeah. Sure book did. Is Triphasic Training. You can find it anywhere. And then I have a tactical manual and a high school manual along with that. And I'll be producing Triphasic Training 2 with Mike T. Nelson with the most advanced methods. And then I also have an exercise manual out probably in a 3 to 4 months on very specific cueing based upon methods of exercise that seem
great.
To fix glute patterns and so forth.
Very cool.
I wanted to add on that if you're done.
Yeah, I'm good.
that his website, my students have been using that for at least 5 years. So when our program design class, I make them go basically search and find program coaches and stuff and present them. And his website is full of so much free and awesome information. So I want to, I don't know if I said that earlier, but thank you for that, because my students have been stealing your work for years.
Oh, that's good.
So it's really good.
I tell people I released my first Triphasic book, and there was a coach in Canada who sent me a program back that the stuff in it was better than mine, so I started using more of his stuff.
Yeah.
To be honest, and I just share information, and it actually comes back to me. So I've been
it's funny how that works.
Yeah, right?
It's a great website.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate
it. Very cool. Andy.
Well, anybody, what are you?
Yeah, not everyone knows you, but go ahead. And
well, if they don't know me, they should just shut off now. No, just kidding. You can actually – I got a new website up. I haven't told you guys about this yet. It's a secret. I'm building it right now. It's up, but it's not really live. Just my name, andygalpin.com. And I'm putting basically the entire undergraduate curriculum that I teach online free.
Oh, wow.
So it's all going up there. Also, I'm going to have little tabs that are basically like ask the expert, where you can go and say if you want to know, like, how much protein should I eat? You can ask that question, and you'll get like a one-minute answer.
Hmm.
Boom. So direct your answer. And then I've got another thing on there actually that links to other resources, like your website is on that link, where it's basically here are all the people I've stole and learned from in the past, or people that I follow, and this is why. Here's why I follow them for, or this website that I like your resources for. So I'm putting all that up.
Cool.
As a resource, guys. So you can check that up there. And then I'm pretty awesome. Good on the you're not very good on social.
I'm not great, no.
Yeah.
But yeah, do you remember what episode number?
Andy's been on a whole
bunch. Yeah, he's been
on,
like, he's been quite a few.
You don't, six.
We didn't really do a great job of letting you talk about yourself, but you've been on the show so much.
I talk enough.
Cool, guys.
What's your social? Are you on social media?
Yeah, I have Cal Dietz or XL Athlete on Twitter.
At XL Athlete,
yeah,
right there.
There you go.
So, and then I just opened up Instagram account. I think I just got 500 people yesterday.
I want to get with you too and get that that document or the article that you talked about with the seven steps
that
we mentioned earlier in the show. I'll so we'll try and have that for you guys as
I think it took me a year to get 500 followers.
Yeah.
A day.
Well,
guys,
strength test a little bit.
You want to plus that? Oh, yeah. And if you haven't yet, make sure you go to shrugstrengthtest.com.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah. I saw that actually. That's really cool.
It's a strength. It's a 3-day test that we build. It's got a bunch of different movements. We walk through day by day and show you how to do each movement. After you take the test, you enter your results. We send you a bunch of feedback on where we think you need to be stronger and then how you can improve. So make sure you check that out.
Really
shrugstrengthtest.com. Guys, thank you so much for coming on. I learned a ton. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
See you.
Enjoy the rest of the weekend.
Awesome.
Yeah. Thanks, Cal.
Yep.